Happy Easter and welcome to everybody who has joined us here in person and is part of our virtual community, following us on Facebook and on our YouTube channel. Even though part of our service is virtual, the presence of Jesus Christ is very real among us and everlasting. Thank you for being here, and our opening hymn is hymn 179, Welcome, Happy Morning. The thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us say together the Gloria.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is the Lord of all. That message spread through Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that anyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 118. It's found on page 360 in the prayer book. Let's do this responsibly by the whole verse. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever.
Let Israel now proclaim, his mercy endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation.
There is a sound of exultation and victory in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed.
I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord has punished me sorely, but he did not hand me over to death.
Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. He who is righteous may enter.
I will give thanks to you, for you answered me, and have become my salvation.
The same stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
On this day the Lord has acted, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Now I should remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which you also are being saved. If you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I, in turn, had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. And then he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to someone ultimately born, he appeared to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Saviour Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is a place they laid him. But go, tell the disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This is the day we have patiently and prayerfully waited for in our 40-day Lenten journey. This most holy day is the central formative event of the Christian Church. We join millions of Christians around the world in celebrating the astonishingly good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We joyfully celebrate the mystery of faith with renewed conviction. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. In vivid contrast to our experience today, more than 2,000 years ago, something different was experienced by the faithful women who had followed Jesus and served in his ministry. All four gospel writers mention that women had accompanied Jesus when he went from Galilee to Jerusalem, and they remained with him, and indeed were even watching from afar at the foot of the cross. We know that Jesus' mother Mary was there as well when Jesus, just before he died, told his disciple to take care of his mother. While the male disciples remained hiding in Jerusalem, fearing for their lives, these three courageous women headed out in the early hours of the morning to the tomb where Jesus had been buried. Mark tells us that they were Mary of Magdalene, Mary, who was the mother of James and Joses, and Salome, the mother of disciples James and John. These women not only knew where the tomb was located, they also knew that Jesus had not been given the dignity of a proper burial. So they had purchased spices to anoint Jesus' body and perform the last rites of a proper Jewish burial. The loving and merciful intentions of these women stood in contrast to the three men, Peter, James, and John, who had been part of the inner circle of Jesus' ministry and yet had remained in hiding. It's hard for us as post-resurrection Christians to understand how astonished these women must have been when they discovered that that huge rock in front of the tomb had been rolled away and that Jesus' body was no longer there when they entered. They must have been startled by the voice and appearance of the angel, who was wrapped in a white robe, which was the same color as Jesus' garments at the time of his transfiguration. He told them to go tell Peter and the disciples that Jesus is going before them to Galilee, where they would see him, just as Jesus had promised. It's interesting that the angel specifically mentioned Peter, because Peter was the one who had denied knowing Jesus three times while Jesus' trial was going on. Mark tells us that the three women fled from the tomb and said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. This is a remarkable statement that abruptly ends the Gospel of Mark. It's perhaps understandable why the women were afraid, because they had not yet seen with their own eyes the risen Lord Christ in Galilee. As post-resurrection Christians, we know how the story continued. But at that moment, the women did not. Their response reminds us of all of the mystery of resurrection and faith. Unlike the other three gospel writers, Mark does not provide proof of the resurrected Jesus Christ. Mark seems to acknowledge the profound mystery of the Easter story. He recognizes that ultimately the most genuine and profound witness to the risen Christ is in the faith and actions of all those who follow Jesus in discipleship. In the same way that the disciples had followed Jesus from Galilee into Jerusalem, now they were to follow Jesus from Jerusalem back to Galilee. The invitation to the three women, the disciples, and Peter to follow Jesus back to Galilee was a renewed call to discipleship. Jesus' ministry of teaching, preaching, and healing had begun in Galilee. It was there that Jesus had called the disciples and Peter to follow him. Jesus had commissioned them there and sent them on a mission to continue his ministry of proclaiming the good news of the gospel. Now, Jesus' glorified presence would be seen once again in Galilee, and the ministry he had begun would continue through the work of these faithful disciples, both men and women. The world order at that time in history had been overturned. The evil intentions of those in Jerusalem and Rome who had opposed Jesus and ensured his execution in an unjust trial were overwhelmed by the actions of God, who raised his beloved son from death on the cross to resurrected life. In the patriarchal culture of that time, in which women had little social status, the last became first, as those three courageous women were entrusted by the angel to proclaim the resurrection message. They became the first apostles. The story of Jesus Christ is not about his fate in the hands of his enemies. It is the account of what God has done in and through Jesus Christ for all of us. The abrupt ending in the Gospel of Mark reminds us that as human beings, we don't know what the future will hold. Like those three faithful women who set out early in the morning, we too set out not knowing what lies ahead of us. Some of our hopes and dreams may be dashed. Some of our prayers may not be answered in exactly the way we want. In many ways, we are like those women, as well as Peter and the other male disciples. At times, we act with great courage and strength in following Jesus. At other times, we're afraid and our faith is weak. There are times when we should have proclaimed the good news of the risen Lord, and yet we remained silent. The most important thing is that no matter who we are or what has happened in our lives, Jesus will always be there ahead of us. The empty tomb means that Jesus never abandons us. However imperfect our faith, and however many times we remain silent when we should testify to the gospel, we can always return to the Lord. None of us can get so far away from Jesus that we cannot be touched by God's healing presence and brought back to Jesus. It's through the witness and work of generations of faithful followers of Jesus over the centuries and our own faithful witness and ministry that the truth of Jesus' resurrection has been preserved. The sting of death has been defeated. Darkness is transformed into light, despair into hope, and death into renewed life. God made possible what was impossible for mankind. The world was transformed and forever changed. It is for that reason that we joyfully proclaim, Alleluia, the Lord is risen. Let us go forth with great joy and boldly proclaim to the world the amazingly good news that our Lord Jesus Christ is risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. I invite you to join me as we reaffirm our faith by saying together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all those who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works
may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble,
that they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. Today, in the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of the Good Shepherd, Lexington, the Reverend Andre Harrison, Rector, the Reverend John Hall, Assistant to the Rector for Pastoral Care and Newcomers, and the Reverend Canon Christian Brady, Clergy Associate. We pray that peace may prevail throughout the world, and are so thankful for our families and loved ones at this time, and for leading many of us safely through COVID.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. To you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, for he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Holy and gracious God, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we'd fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and maker of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, Almighty God, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Savior, by Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us speak the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Let us pray.
Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God, who has redeemed us and made us his children through the resurrection of the Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the richness of his blessing. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is hymn number 207, Jesus Christ is Risen Today.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Have a blessed and holy Easter.